Ooh. When you say that you kill in the name of God or in the name of Allah, you are truly cursing God, for that is not of God. When you say that you hate in the name of God or Allah, you are lying to God, for that is not of our Father. Let us pray that we see the light. Good morning, or evening, friends. Here's your friendly announcer. I have serious news to pass on to everybody. What I'm about to say could mean the world's disaster. Change your joy and laughter to tears and pain. It's that love in need of today. Don't delay.
Respect yourself. Happy Monday to each of you, and welcome to our show. This is Perspective. This is Season 2, Episode 61. Again, happy Monday to each of you, and welcome to our amazing show, Perspective. This is Episode Season 2, Episode 61. So very excited about tonight. Actually going to do something different that we've never done before. So if you're usually tuning in and you're like, okay, I wonder what conversation they're going to blow me with tonight. Well, tonight we're going to have fun. No deep conversations tonight. We're going to have fun. Now, let me put a disclaimer out. Some of the things that we discuss may make you think. So you may get a few little deep pointers here and there, but tonight we're going to have fun, lighthearted conversation. For those of you who've been tuning in, you should know what we're talking about. We are talking about the Bel-Air Season 1 review. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. These two ladies that are joining me tonight, and we're supposed to have a male joining tonight, but if he doesn't join, it will just be me and these beautiful two ladies. We're talking about Bel-Air, which is the reimagining of the sitcom, The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. So I'm excited. You're not going to see any formal introductions like we started tonight. Let's just go ahead and get this conversation started. First guest tonight is Miss Yolanda Brathwaite. She was actually a guest on our show Monday before last. She's an amazing author. She's the founder of Grown Girls in New York and Atlanta. Let's go ahead and bring her in. Good evening.
Hello.
Hello. Welcome. I am great. Good to have you on. And our next guest, Miss Arlillian Bushelon. She was our first guest for Women's History Month. She is the manager of Bushelon Funeral Home Incorporated and also the founder of West End Food Park. Hello, hello, hello.
Hi, hi. How are y'all doing tonight?
Hello.
And y'all go ahead and tag and share, because I definitely can tell you you're going to get some laughs tonight. We're just going to talk about Bel-Air. So for those watching tonight and y'all are like, what is Bel-Air? We're going to bring you up to speed. So we're going to try to get as much as we can in the hour and 20-minute show. Plus, you still will get our entertainment segment tonight. So everything that we talk about tonight is entertainment. So you're going to get a full load of tonight. So let's go ahead and get started. And ladies, what I kind of want to do, I realize that I never did this. Before we get started in our conversation, let's show the official trailer that Morgan Cooper created, where he shared it with Will Smith, and then I think that will be a good place to pick up our dialogue. So after the trailer, we'll be right back to you guys.
See, for some reason you think this is a game. This is not a game, Will. Look at you. Look at you. The only reason why you're not in jail is because Uncle Phil called in a favor.
Take your time. Go deep.
Champion!
So easy.
You throw this?
You're stupid.
You are carrying a gun on the streets to protect yourself? I've done my best, Will. It is time for a change. You're going to Bel-Air to live with your uncle and your auntie.
Bel-Air, out of all places.
This is a second chance, Will. Don't waste it.
Will, I will not bail you out again.
In this house, I'm not Uncle Phil.
I'm the law. Have I made myself absolutely clear?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are no butlers to clean up your messes. You've got to be responsible for yourself.
So, Will, what brings you to Bel-Air?
I got caught with a gun.
How are we related again?
He's from the streets of Philadelphia.
Will needs discipline.
Just a little time. Just a little time and a little love. We are what he needs.
Why don't you go back to Philly? Born and raised, right?
You think I would ever want to be in this life?
You're not welcome, Will.
This is fake.
Wherever you're from,
this is fake. You didn't do anything to earn this. I never had nothing.
My life ain't a sitcom, I guess. I don't even feel like I belong here.
Just give it some time. Everything happens for a reason.
Yo, you must be from Philly.
Yeah. What's up, man? I'm Will.
Jazz.
Jazz?
Hey, so what part of town you staying in?
Bel Air. They got you out there?
All right, Philly. Let's see what you got. Well, welcome to Bel Air Academy.
How's everything going up, Bel Air?
Not too bad out here.
I just made the team.
I'm so proud of you.
I'm so glad you're here. I need to take you shopping. Rodeo Drive. Oh, my gosh.
I was summoned by God to be the greatest. They said my birth is a curse, I still made it. I stood out in the field when it was raining. 10 toes down in it, youngin' came up strong with a will to live. Daddy never came home, mama in the pen. So it's relative, got him from the devil did. The streets ain't safe, just be playing in. It's like deja vu, I see it all the time. Yeah, it's like deja vu.
Hey, Jazz.
Hey, Prince.
You even go here?
Nah.
And so that's how we got to where we are now, the wonderful reimagined series of Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, Bel-Air, which premiered on Sunday, February the 13th. And the three of us have all talked about it. We've all felt the same way. Ladies, I don't know about y'all, but every week I can't wait until Thursday gets here. And then Yolanda, I know it's a delay on your end, so you don't get them until Friday.
Yes.
But every week I can't wait until Thursday gets here. So I tell you what, before we get down into the breakdown of the season, let's talk about some of the differences. And I promise y'all, if you're watching tonight and you've never seen it, we promise not to give away too many spoilers. But even if we give them away, us saying it is still something that it would make you watch. It's just that you just have to see it. Even us talking about it, it doesn't do it justice. So when you all saw, because they did us a favor and we got to see 3 episodes the first night it premiered. What were some things that you saw that kind of blew you away and you weren't expecting? Arlillian, we'll start with you first and then we'll go back to Yolanda.
Well, first of all, Jeffrey is like a undercover boss. Like, that was definitely not in the original Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, which I think is a breath of fresh air. I like the new perspective on Jeffrey. Jeffrey was the comedic relief in the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, but now, I mean, he's a little mysterious. And, you know, it's a lot of questions still looming about him, but I absolutely love to imagine that character. I don't know if you want me to go down the list, but one thing that really stood out, Ashley, I love that they're introducing the conversation of younger people in your family discovering who they are. And I love those sweet conversation that she had with Hillary when she essentially came out to her. And that is something that, you know, growing up, a lot of our life lessons came from Bill Cosby's show. From the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. So looking at that and watching that, that might even be teaching older family members on how to deal with transitioning into the conversation with their younger family members or any family member, and taking it with the sensitivity that it should be taken with and the seriousness that it should be taken with. I don't want to take over all the characters, so chime in and take over some of them, talk about some of the characters, that's cool, but I absolutely love how they reimagine everybody, except for Lisa. Something about Lisa that doesn't sit well with me, probably because she dated Carlton, but other than that, I like her, but that whole backstory of her dating Carlton, I think they should have left that out.
We're going to get to that in a minute, because I want to spend some time on that. And audience, we don't want y'all to be quiet tonight, because I know some people on here, y'all have seen Bel-Air. I've seen you comment on other people's posts. So if you have a favorite moment you want to share, definitely share it in the comments and we'll get it on the screen and we'll respond to it. All right, Yolanda, what about you?
Okay, first of all, I want to say I'm glad they changed the characters from that trailer.
I forgot all about that trailer because it was, you know, they showed it so long ago. But the right. characters are very different. I'm glad they have Jazz not up at the high school like he just was in the trailer. And just actually, he's like sort of like a guardian angel, I kind of say, for Will. You know, he's the voice of reason. So I do right. like that they changed that instead of them just being like the best of friends. Mm-hmm. What did take me also for a little loop is that Hillary and Jazz got together.
Yes.
I was like, wow, I didn't, you know, I really didn't see that coming as being serious. I see the flirtation at the beginning, but other than that, I didn't think it was going to be a real connection. But I totally agree with you as well with that whole Lisa and Carlton. Like, where did that come from? You know, so, yeah, but the show is awesome. I love it. And I have a couple more questions I like to get into. Yeah.
Okay.
With this show. Yeah.
And then other standing moments in the first episode, we were introduced to Will's friend, Trey. In the sitcom, he was just, I think, a one-time character that we saw one time, and he wasn't introduced anymore, so it was good to see their dialogue. And I also like how we got to see a little bit of what was life like for Will in West Philly in the beginning.
Yes.
Because, you know, in the sitcom, we didn't even see what West Philly looked like until like season 4 or 5. That was when the entire family went out to see Aunt Vi. And then that was when Will decided he wasn't sure if he wanted to go back to Bel-Air. So, and we'll definitely get to this. That's a question that a lot of people are asking now. Are we going to see it already because of the way season episode 10 ended? Are we going to see it where he goes back to West Philly? So that's definitely a question we'll take a few moments before we end the segment tonight to discuss. So yeah, those are a few knockouts. And we've also seen two of the original cast members. Well,
yes.
Aunt Viv of number 2, and then the
yeah.
original lady who played Will's mom, which leaves uh-huh. the question, will have any other aunts? Because for those of you who are Fresh Prince, like everything, you know that Will's aunts in the original sitcom, his other two aunts were Helen and Janice. Well, these uh-huh. two women serve on the art board. Their
yes.
names are Helen and Janice. So again, it leaves the question in this one, are just Vi and Vivian sisters, or what are we going to see? We also haven't seen Philip's mom, who was in a lot of episodes in the sitcom.
Mm-hmm.
Is she deceased, or will we see her? Those are questions. And here's another one I want to go ahead and address to start dialogue. With where Vivian is going, she's saying she's put her life on hold for everyone else. It's her time to shine. We do know that Philip has dropped out of the race for running for district attorney. Will there be a baby Nikki in the reimagining? Will she get pregnant in this one? Here's a little side note many of you did not know. They actually wrote that into the sitcom because Janet Hubert, she was actually pregnant with a son in real life.
Yes.
Not to say that won't happen in this one, but that is one question that I've already had. Or let's just go ahead and address the elephant in the room. Will somebody else have a baby? And I think those who've seen it, everyone knows who we're talking about. So there's just a lot of really twists and turns that they've already taken.
Yeah.
Like, wait a minute now.
I'm thinking that Aunt Viv, I don't think they're gonna add that pregnancy in, but I'm wondering if they're going to add no virtual slaps. Nobody. Don't send no virtual slaps. But if they're going to have an entanglement with the art guy. You know,
yeah,
it feels like he's really, you know, feeling her. So I
right.
was actually wondering about that. Is, you know, when she starts traveling, he's there. Now she even asks to work with him to find other artists. So I was wondering, is that going to be like an issue that may come up?
Yeah, because for those who are go ahead, Arlillian.
Playing with fire with the gallery guy Michael Eatley. I don't remember his real name or the name on the show.
Yeah,
but she's playing with fire, and I think mm-hmm. she knows she's yeah. playing with fire. She's toying around with the idea of a relationship a little further than just the art gallery. I mean,
right.
you're not going to put yourself in situations with that person if you're not feeling something. So I think it's going to get really interesting in season two with that.
That's the same way I feel too. And then like her husband knew, Phil knew, like he feel the vibe, you know. That's why he showed up at one of the events they was there at. He just popped out of nowhere, and with like with the jealousy going on and everything, and the fact that he don't have Jeffrey right now at this moment to search out and keep an eye on that, who knows, the entanglement may start.
And we go back to the sitcom.
Yeah, because like you said, she's playing with fire.
Yeah, and on the sitcom,
they also have her like kind of naive, like, no, this is not him. He's not doing that. Yeah. You know, but we all see, you know,
she's looking at it as an opportunity.
Yeah,
and yeah, sometimes you can be, you can see the signs, and you can choose to ignore them for whatever reason, but. I have to just call it what it is. Sometimes in relationships, notice I just didn't say marriage, in any type of relationships, one or the other can see things that you can't see. And so you know that Philip, he's already seeing some things. And for those who remember from the sitcom, in the sitcom, it wasn't on Vivian. They wrote in the script in the sitcom where I think they were preparing for Easter, and the pastor at the church, he had an attraction for Vivian. And she actually had to dismiss him, to say in so many words, hey, if this doesn't stop, you know, I'm going to tell my husband, because this isn't right. So that one ended. So very anxious to see, what happens. And yeah, Rashonda, yeah, that's definitely something.
I think she was calling.
And how do y'all feel about Lisa's father now becoming, what is it? Is it a district attorney? What is he going to be now?
Attorney.
Right, because Phil stepped down to be with the family.
Correct.
Like, so I think that could possibly happen. Lisa get pregnant. He's in a district attorney. It doesn't look good kind of thing. And then it's going to be Will. So that's already a rift with the family already. You know,
right, yeah.
Well, we have heard on him too, so he's not coming out of this clean. It came out at the party for his deceased wife that he was cheating on her while she was sick with his current wife.
Yes, he's not clean either.
So I'm pretty sure they can throw it back on him some kind of way.
Yeah, and she doesn't even look like she fit in the show. She just don't know why. Yeah,
not at all. Mm-mm.
Lisa don't like her. She's more stuck to Aunt Viv. You know, she's always at the house. That, you know, Viv do a lot of things for her, and she wants no part of the new mom, the new wife, I should say.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. And then they were embarrassed at the fundraiser. They were embarrassed right in front of the whole crowd. Mm-hmm. So I'm pretty sure whatever goes down with Lisa, that the Smith family will. Well, are they the Smith family in that show? I'm not sure, but family in Bel Air, will take her in and you know, make her feel welcome, because you know, I really don't see that working for her.
Since you brought up the fundraiser, you remember when the art dude, he actually bought her painting, him and her husband. Mm-hmm. No one really bought it. So I was wondering, see, that was his way of getting in with her more.
Mm-hmm. Most definitely.
You know? So that's why.
A fundraiser. I've been to silent auctions before, but to see $20,000 on a silent auction, that's a dope auction right there. I would love to put on an auction like that. Yeah, I mean, he took a lot of liberties. He was walking around the house. He went into her studio.
Yes.
For them to have that much help around the house, I don't see how he made it into the art studio.
Absolutely. Right.
Yeah, and then, see, that's when Uncle Phil, he you know, he felt that. Even when Aunt Viv came in there with the art guy, I can't think of his name on the show. Do he even have a name? Are they calling him anything? Because I can't.
Yeah, Jeffrey mentioned his name and told him that he was on it, but I can't remember what his name was.
And you see the way they were talking, and like him with them eyes, it's like he already seducing her. And so Phil came right in, and he was like, "Nah, you can go." So
well, then something else I don't think we really talked about, Judge Robinson. I said this, I think it was the show with me and you and I, Yolanda. Mm-hmm. So in the original sitcom, Judge Robinson was played by Sherman Hemsley. Yes. And so you can tell where they're taking this Judge Robinson. They're up to the same thing. The same thing.
Shenanigans, yes. Yes.
I believe that if Philip had not dropped out of the race, Judge Robinson was going to step on Fred's side, mm-hmm. and they were just going to find a way to destroy the Banks family. Yes. And we'll see it. So that was one thing, one area I was glad to see where they took the writing, because he could have let power and prestige get the best of him and say, hey, you know, we'll just have to deal with these issues around this. I'm not dropping out of the race.
Right. Because,
you know, a lot of times in reality, you don't see that. You know, you see them still trying to take care of their household and stay in the race. So I was glad that the writers, they went that direction. So that's different. That's going to definitely take us in a different area.
Exactly.
And
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, and it might push him to a point of resentment, especially if there is an entanglement, that he put his career on hold for her to live out her dreams so she wouldn't resent him. And then she goes on and, you know, goes into the art world, maybe entanglement with Michael Ealy, and then begins to resent her for putting his dreams on hold for her.
Yeah, you know what? Because it's, when you said that, that even brought back, I think, I don't know where they was at. It was like some type of party or whatever. And they had asked him, what is your next move? And he was like, I don't know. You know, like, so he already haven't decided. So he might, like you said, get into a slump and resent her. And she's going off being big in the art world. So, yeah. Because he don't have a plan B. Like, he just he don't know what he's going to do next. So, you know, idle minds. Because,
you know, the sitcom, he was a lawyer running for judge. And so in this one, it's night and day. So, you know, at least if he was still the lawyer running for judge, if he didn't win the judge's seat, he still would have had the law firm. So it's different. Here's something I want to spend a few moments on. The feud between the Smith sisters. So that was actually episode 9.
Yes.
Kind of like resentment. Yeah. We kind of saw it like being played out, you know, like dialogue here and there. But in episode 9, we saw it even from the time Vi landed on the family's personal jet. And when Vivian reached out to hug her, you know, we were all like, okay, is she going to hug her or what? And they did hug, and she said, it's good to see you too. And so we heard things such as, it's been 20 years since Vi has been to Bel Air. It's been like years since they really were a family. And then Hillary brought up, you know, the dinners that they used to have at her grandmother's house. And then we get the bombshell. I says, well, I was the only one taking care of mom, which that was another thing that leads me to believe that they'll be the only two sisters in this one.
Yeah, and I was going to mention that.
Yeah, and then Vivian goes to speak, well, we spent money. And I know we don't like to hear that, but these episodes, they aren't just for entertainment, but they deal with issues that are going on in every family. Because everybody watching, even if it's not your family, we all know somebody where when it came down to the caregiving status of a loved one, you've been at odds, you know, even if it was simple as, well, who's going to take mama to the doctor? Who's going to take daddy to here and there? Who's going to make sure big mama eats? You know, you can come at odds. So I'm glad, again, the writer is portraying these realistic things on television.
Yeah.
I was glad to see that brought up, because I actually went through that. I have a sibling, my brother, and both of us are actually in the funeral industry. And around 20, let's just say 2009, my dad's health started really declining. He had multiple sclerosis. Both of us were working at his firm. He had just started in 2009. And I came home to take care of my dad. And just like, you know, just like the money was being sent to the home, but not necessarily actual care, the hands-on experience with being a caregiver, I had to take care of all those things. I never had resentment towards my brother because he was working on our other goal of building up another funeral home. Right. But I definitely love that they put that in there, because so many times with me dealing with bereaved families, right before they were bereaved family, they were going through being the caregiver for their families. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of tension between them because I didn't get any sleep. I, you know, lost my life to taking care of our loved one, and you guys were just living your lives. Mm-hmm. So I love that they put that in there. I hope they deeper into that, maybe even go to therapy, because they have a lot of resentment towards each other, a lot of anger towards each other, a lot of unresolved things. I don't want to say the names because I might get them wrong. Will's mom might be dealing with, she might have been dealing with anticipatory grief. And the other family may not known about that. She may have seen her mother declining and going through things that most people don't have to deal with because they're not there 24/7 dealing with someone who may be passing or very terminally ill. And it's frustrating sometimes when you have someone seemingly living their life, doing their thing. They might send money or whatever, but they're not actually there hands on. So right. I love that they brought that up. I hope they move that into storyline in season 2 so they can kind of resolve things and move forward. But jewels like that dropped in the show kind of current, because maybe back then we didn't have as many home deaths because people were living. I mean, most people were dying at the hospital or whatnot. Now we're bringing our loved ones home due to home health and hospice. So that's one of those subjects that definitely needs to be touched on and brought to reality for families to learn how to deal with those things.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah. And you know what? It adds a lot of stress on the one person that is taking care of the loved one. It's a lot of stress. It's a lot, especially if they have their own family. They working, they moving around, trying to take care of the parent, the loved one, in between of them having their own lives too. It can be draining. It can be somewhat depressing for them. And it adds a lot of stress to the person. So, if they dig deeper into that, that would be really good. Really good. You know, one thing I did like, because I was having this conversation with a lot of other people. Some people say they don't like the show simply because it's not what it used to be and think like and stuff like that. But I was saying, for this time and this generation that we're in, it's perfect. I like the fact that Carlton is not the perfect kid like he was in the show. He was doing drugs, you know? And you would think that would be like Will, the bad boy from Philly, into that. But it's the good rich kid, you know? And he said it was helping his anxiety. So they brought that up, you know, him with anxiety and stuff like that. So they're touching on some real family matters and human matters, human issues that happen. Mm-hmm. So right. I like that.
Right. And if we remember from the sitcom, Carlton really wasn't, you know, all that squeaky clean, because in the sitcom, you know, they wrote in the script where it was a possibility he fathered a child out of wedlock. Coming to find out, he wasn't the father. That was that was a hilarious.
What's her name that played Lisa Turtle on Saved by the Bell? She was the mother.
Yeah, I can't never think of her now. Yeah, she was the mother. It was hilarious. And then there was a scene where episode where Will got drugs from one of his classmates, because he was working, going to school, trying to manage, and it was during prom season. And so Carlton went to Will's locker. He was thinking that it was vitamin D, and it was not vitamin D. Right. So they tied it in that episode where he actually dealt with using drugs. So they're kind of taking things from the sitcom and expanding them. But here's what I realized as a writer. You can't please everybody. And if one more person says it's not the same, it's not supposed to be the same. You're talking about really a 24-minute sitcom, because you got to give an account for commercials, and you're squeezing that into a 45-minute, you know, drama, it's going to be night and day. Yeah, they're giving us a little humor, you know, humor in this one, but it's not supposed to be all totally funny.
Right. And it's real life. It's for this generation. Right. I mean, I don't think back then when the sitcom was going on, it was too much of Ashley being openly gay or, you know, secretly gay, whatever. But, you know, she's into that world there with girls liking girls. And it wasn't, maybe back in the sitcom, it may have been weed. He was actually doing sniffing, you know, had it laid out. So you can't compare it to. I mean, this is the new generation. And I'm sure somebody have some one of those characters in their family, whether they want to say it or not, you know, a cousin, an uncle, or whatever, you know. So you can relate. It's right. Very relatable.
And now let's talk about the difference between, my dad just posted this in the comments, the house in Bel-Air versus the sitcom. You talking about a mansion, and if we really think about it, in the sitcom, everything was always centrally filmed in the living room, the kitchen. We saw the pool house a lot of times. Mm-hmm. We saw the dining room a few times, but we really didn't like go from bedroom to bedroom. But in this, we get to see like the mansion for what it is. Yeah. And to see Blacks being in a positive spotlight, it's just a great thing to watch. So,
The house back then, I think, what year was all that happening? In the early 90s?
The 90s. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Right. And back then, that house was huge for that time. It was really huge for that time. If you even put that house now, you'd be like, what? There ain't no Bel-Air house, you know what I mean? So the house that they have, I do like that they go from room to room. It's just not no section. But, you know, you got to look like you're living that Kardashian life.
I love that they're spotlighting, and it's a lot of it's realistic. Mm-hmm. I love that they're spotlighting that more affluent people love paintings and see the worth of art. And you can really see all the art in the house, from the stairwell to all around the house. You're seeing all these beautiful pieces.
Yes.
And it's kind of, you know, teaching you about the culture of people who are more affluent and what they put money in versus what we find, you know, worth putting money in. I love the jewel. I don't know if they mentioned Jack and Jill, which is a Black organization for more affluent families, or if it was like a hint nudge to it that Carlton and Lisa may have grew up in that type of environment. But I love how when they brought Trey on, and it was showing how people don't know how to deal with people who come into money or grow up.
Right.
I could relate to that too. Although I, you know, grew up quote unquote rich, as people would say, I went to public school. So being picked up in limos and things like that, people are like, what in the world? But I love that they can kind of touch on that and show the differences in how kids grow up and them not knowing certain things about people's lifestyles, and they might pick on them or might down it. I love that it's showing another side to kids, teenagers that are living an affluent lifestyle, where they throw these extravagant parties at the house, where they all have their own cars, where they're all, you know, doing things that they're not worrying about having to have a job after school and whatnot. I love how it's teaching that there are other aspects to life, even when you're in different age groups, and it makes it more acceptable and people to just kind of get it. Sometimes people don't get it when they're not brought around that type of environment. So I'm actually really, really loving that they even touch on that in the show, which is going to help a lot of kids who may grow up affluent or not affluent, and kind of have an idea of what that other side looks like. So when they're there, for lack of better words, you can act like you've been there before.
Absolutely. So do you think Trey was hating, jealous of Will, you know, level up since he left Philly? You think?
Sometimes people may think that people have changed, and I think that that's what Trey was really feeling, that his friend changed, but no, yes, his circumstances have changed that have put him in a better position.
Right.
And Trey didn't understand that. He felt like he was selling out and moving on without him. And that was hard for him to understand. And I hope in season two they can reconcile and see where they were wrong in their relationship, because I really do think they had a really genuine, because that was like a breakup for Will. Will was hurt.
Yeah, he was hurt. He was hurt. Yeah. Well, you know, also, I wouldn't mind if it doesn't, if they two don't get back together, because it would show that sometimes you have to move forward.
True.
Right.
You know what I mean? You outgrow situations and you're going on a different path, you know? So,
and I think his aunt said that after the pulled out, you guys were sent in different ways.
Right. You know, so, you know, either way, I'm good with, but I hope it, you know, I really hope it doesn't, because it show you the dynamics between the two, you know.
Yeah, and my dad brought up a great point. Trey could have felt that Will deserted him.
Yeah,
but here's the thing: there are some people who grow up in, you know, as we would say it, and it is what it is. What their lifestyle in West Philly, that would be considered what we would say now is the hood. Back then, we said the ghetto. And some people, it's just hard for them to adapt to a different way of living. It doesn't make them bad people. It's just hard for them to adapt to different lifestyles. And again, it doesn't make them bad people. That's just the lifestyle that they've chosen. And if you're just tuning in tonight, we are talking about the Bel-Air Season 1 review. So, audience, again, keep coming with those comments. We would love for you to share your favorite moment from season one. And we're just enjoying the commentary that we're sharing tonight. Let's talk about Hillary for a few moments. So we all know her from the sitcom.
Right.
Hillary didn't have them all. She did not have them all. I think, and I laugh at this episode every time it comes on, my favorite Hillary moment, Will and Carlton were trying to get into a fraternity. And the fraternity wanted Will, but they didn't accept Carlton because they felt like he was too much of a sellout. And so when they came home and told their family, you know, why they weren't accepted, they said, well, Top Dog felt like Carlton was too much of a sellout and he doesn't like sellouts. Hillary's reply was, well, who doesn't like sellouts? I mean, you stand in line all day and you get to the front of the line and you wait and you wait and you wait and everything's gone. So when they showed the trailer for the reimagining, I'm like, okay, Hillary can't be that dumb in this one. Please. Right. You know, she's a political cook. She's her own woman.
Yes.
Sometimes she doesn't make the wise decisions, but that's one thing I will say was the biggest comparison. Both Hillary's, they were their own woman. This one knows what she wants, and she's going to get there, bad or ugly, right or wrong. And so I love the way that she's the voice of reason when it comes to her siblings and Will, because that was once upon a time how it was in households. You always had that older sibling that you could go to talk to things you couldn't talk to your mom or your dad or your grandparents about. You always had a sibling. So that's another area that I'm glad the writer took. I want to get y'all perspective on Hillary. I know we talked about the Hillary and Jazz, but what are some other ways that they've taken Hillary that kind of stood out to you?
Thank goodness she's not a ditz.
Yes, I agree with you. Like,
I needed her to be smart. I need her to be an influencer. Like, it's 2022 and Hillary is an influencer. She's got these followers. She's got her niche on what brings attention to her to make money. She just hasn't gotten in the right spot because, of course, that influencer house didn't work out for her. You could tell from the beginning that wasn't going to work out, but you got to let people kind of feel their way through things. So I'm really, really happy that Hillary is not a ditz, that she can cook. Like, she is the cook. Jeffrey didn't cook anything. She cooks. And then also, I'm really glad that she's finding her own way. She's not, you know, leaning on the support of her parents to make it in the 2022 influencer lifestyle where she wants to influencer via cooking.
Right. Now, let's see. Is that Carucci?
No.
And That's not her and her friend, her new friend. Oh, okay. I was like, is that Karrueche? It just looks like her a little bit. But yeah, I'm glad that she's finding her own way as well. And like she even talking to her mom, even the situation where they had with when her mom, when she told her mom some news and her mother came back with, oh, do you think that's right? Just be happy for me. You know, like just say I'm proud of you. And I thought that was a telling moment too, you know. And then Viv had to come back in like, oh my God, do I always do this? You know what I mean? Let me try to check myself on that so that I won't, you know, come off like that. Even the father has said, the husband has said one time, can you keep it at a minimum tonight? You know what I mean? You don't have to say what you're thinking and stuff like that. So she, you can say she's very, Viv is very strong, strong opinion. She has a strong opinion about things. But yeah, Hillary is learning. And I like that. She's still responsible though, too. At the same time, you know, they leave her in charge of the house when they had the party and stuff like that. So, you know, she's cooking. She decided she didn't want to go kind of like semi-nude for the content, for the cooking. You know, she's like, that's not me. That's not my brand. And she stuck with it. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I like the way that they're taking advantage to put social media in the reimagining. Of course, social media wasn't even thought about during the sitcom. So I love the way that they are using that in this. So
that's what I was saying, like a new generation. For the generation, they need that. They have to have all the things that can connect with the audience, young or old, you know what I mean?
Right. So and that's even really good. If you think about Vivian, she's just like Vivian One, because they've given the Vivian in the drama the nickname Vivian 3, but she's just like Vivian 1, you know, hood, don't mind fighting for her family, what comes up, you know. She's just that West Philly that's learned to balance the Bel Air life. So I love to see, you know, where she's going with that. But all of the characters are good. Had a funny question. Have not seen Maid to First, because who cleans up this big old house? Maybe we'll see those in like season 2, because like I said, Jeffrey has not picked up a broom. He ain't pulled out no Fabuloso. He ain't pulled out
I did notice when they went to the refrigerator, because I was thinking that too. And then when they went to the refrigerator, they was like, there's no food here because Jeffrey's not here. So I was like, okay, Jeffrey's doing that too?
I think Jeffrey is more so like the house manager and assigned people to things. Mm-hmm. And I really think the maids are those dope maids. Like, I've only had this experience once. I had a suite in a hotel and we never saw the maids, period. We would hear doors open when we were in other rooms, and it was almost like they can look in on the rooms.
Yeah.
But basically their job is to get in there, straighten it up, come on back.
Not to be seen. Yeah.
So that might be the type of maid service they have, which I think is dope.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Let's talk about the Southern when Vivian was, when Vi was there. She cooked a traditional Southern breakfast. She did the ham steaks. I think we saw French toast, waffles, chicken. Because we got to remember, the Smith girls are from the South. So she still brought a little bit of that Southern tradition in, which I think is great. It really is.
Yeah.
Wait, they're from the South?
The Smith girls are. Well, no, I'm sorry. So this was another twist. In the it can be confusing. In the sitcom, Vi moved to West Philly, but in the sitcom, the Smith girls were from the South, and Philip, he was like from North Carolina, wherever.
Yamacraw.
So in this one, we really don't know where Yamacraw is. We just know it's a small country town. But in this one, they're West Philly, so they still have to have Southern roots, because I know people in West Philly and we've had a laughing joke. We was like, they was like, we don't eat like that in West Philly. We would love to. A lot of those products we don't even have available. So that was a good tribute to the South.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if this is on your list of things to talk about, but I absolutely love like how they throw little tidbits of the TV show into the dramedy. Even starting off the entire season, the very first thing that they put is first things first. And really, what you're supposed to think in your head, rest in peace, Uncle Phil. Like, I love how they did that. I think he was, the Will actually almost start saying the rap song, I Got in a Little Trouble.
My mom's
right
here.
Right.
Yeah.
I love how they threw that in there. And then his mannerism that your Will did that on the TV show.
Yes.
I think Jazz did something once that was like, that's Jazz from the TV show. It's like every once in a while, they'll throw something in there that if you didn't watch the TV show or aficionado of the TV show, you wouldn't get it. But for me, those little tidbits mean so much. Yeah. Like, thank you for still, you know, showing.
Like adding it. You know what I was thought was super cool, too, is how in the original sitcom, you remember when he was going to private school, but he flipped his jacket inside out. And they showed how that began in the season. He got like some mustard on it, and he was like, "Oh!" And he flipped it. You know, I was really happy with that. I was like, "Oh my God!" They like you said, they adding a little tidbit. So you know, even if you watched it back then, you remember that. Like, oh, I remember. That's how he got his jacket like that. So yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah, and even the way Will has said, like, "Hey," in the past two episodes, it was like, "Hey," and that's how Will said it. In the sitcoms, yeah, it's definitely dope. It's definitely dope.
Yeah.
Man, I saw your comment. We're gonna go to that in a moment. We gotta talk about Will's dad. So, first of all, if you all did not see Marlon Wayans in Respect when he portrayed Ted White, who was Aretha Franklin's first husband, I told my family then, I said Marlon is gonna get more dramatic roles.
Yeah.
I had even when he was said to play dramatic roles before, you couldn't take him serious because he would always throw comedy in there.
Right.
When he played Ted White again, that was Aretha's first husband. He took you on the journey, and I said he may not get an award for this, but this won't. It definitely won't be his last dramatic role.
And yeah, he did play that good.
Has a better person to play Luke's father. I mean, just the energy. Just it was a perfect way to end the season. A perfect way.
Yeah. To end the season. You know, so, that whole thing had me a little curious. Like, what is the secret? They always trying to hide something. You know, like it was a secret like between Phil, Aunt Viv, and Will's mother. I was like, did they frame him? What happened? You know, because they always like didn't read. What if he know? What did we do? You know what I mean? I was like, what happened? You know? So
I'm still kind of clueless on that. I watched that part multiple times, and I'm seeing something I'm still not catching.
Yeah, you know what? Because I'm thinking, because I feel the same way. I'm thinking for the hype of the secret before everything came out, you would have think that it would have been something like explosive, like they framed him or something, you know, and put him in jail or something to that effect. But it was just like he robbed somebody. You know what I mean? So then why were they so scared to keep, you know, to tell Will?
But it was,
I remember even one time on Bill was like, he's going to hate us for what we did.
Right. But it was deep enough for when Carlton read it.
Yes.
Was to take it to Will. You know, he was like, you got to read this. You got to read this.
Yes. Yeah. Because, I mean, Jeffrey got fired over it. So, you know, I'm thinking like it was a murder case. What happened? You know? Yeah. So I wouldn't say I was disappointed, but I was on that part. But I was expecting a little more. You know,
but even that's reality. You know, you have some families, what goes on in the house, in the family, stays in the house, in the family, and those secrets sometimes when they are revealed by another family member, it always does not turn out to be the best moment. So I think that's what season two is really going to reveal. And then you know, now I think, as we saw at the end, Vi is going to continue to blame herself. Like, you know, if I had just been honest with my child, we wouldn't even be into this. And, you know, I get it. You know, there's some things you want to protect your child from, But, you know, he's at that age now. He needs to know. Yeah. And as we saw, he and his father's meeting, it was not the best meeting. As when I realized there was him, as soon as the doorbell rung, I said, that's Lou. And, you know, just kind of things that have been adding up to this moment.
It seemed like Lou got a little temper, too, because he was talking smooth with Will, and then, your mama made me do all the depression, you know? She was the worst thing that ever happened to me, you know, like that. I'm like, okay, well, calm down. I see why they don't want you to meet him.
Right, and I don't care what nobody say, regardless of who you are, when you go to your mama as a child, it makes you fire up. It happens before you realize it. You know, that's just one of those thin lines you don't cross. And, you know, that all that resentment that Will had built up on, it came out.
Yeah.
And I'm glad they threw that out, because I think some men do feel that way. Maybe they weren't the most educated or had the most opportunities. And then when they engage in a relationship with a woman, sometimes the woman does push them. They really do push them. Hopefully not to push them to hurt an elderly man and steal from him. But that's a real situation where men are really trying to make a point or try to take care of their family. And the woman pushes them to do whatever you got to do, because you got to take care of us. So I'm glad they brought that up, because that's something real that needs to be talked about. And that's I think the overall theme of the TV show. It's bringing out the conversations that we need to be having, that need to be a commonplace every day. This is what happens in a family. These are some solutions of how we can take care of it in a healthy manner. So I'm really, really glad of all these gems that are being dropped all through the show. I wish we could sit here and just analyze each show, because each show has such great gems.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah, I agree. I totally agree with you. Yeah. So I think they're just going to dive in a little deeper because I think Will's mom, she probably was, from what I'm getting from what Will's father is saying, is that she started comparing her to Viv. You know, they started making money. He started, Uncle Phil started getting more money. And then, like you said, she was pushing him. So, you know, it's not always just the men. You know, sometimes, like you said, the women, you know, do things as well. And they need to be held accountable for that as well.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
So, and with this, Jeffrey, it's so many situations that he's taken care of, even when Ashley Snow with her friends. And he, you know, took on that daddy role. And he got Ashley. It wasn't no discussion, you know.
Yeah. Yes, when she was over at the house. Yes.
Jeffrey is definitely the guardian angel for that family. And they're already having him being missing just with the car key. I mean, the car to track the car to see where Will is.
Yeah.
Jeffrey to track the car.
Yes.
So, exactly. The family, we can't do anything without Jeffrey. I think that the dad just, Uncle Phil just, he was just upset, and I really think that's going to be reversed. I mean, you can't write Jeffrey out. Jeffrey is part of it.
But I think Viv is going to be the person that gets Jeffrey back, because if you could tell, he told the kids, he said it was a mutual decision that Jeffrey, she said, mutual decision, I didn't have anything to do with that.
Exactly. But do you think he fired him because he gave Will that, or because he was once telling, Jeffrey was telling Phil the truth? Because he was like, you let your family can't handle all this. He like really, really went in on Phil.
Phil also threw back on him about his son. So
Yeah. And see, I thought that was a little selfish too, because Phil should understand. You know, if this somebody that been with you for a while, of course he's missing his son too. So, you know, why not? But he was telling Phil the truth. And I think that hurted him and stung, because he was like, watch yourself. You know what I mean? Right. And sometimes, you know, when you tell the truth, it's not what you really want to hear.
Mm-hmm.
But it's something you needed to hear, because I think that helped him change his mind as well of not running for district. Between that and then the secret behind how Will got to the their location. Yeah, so that was a combination of both of those. Probably had him to step down. You know? So do you think Jeffrey's going to return?
He has to. It's like, to be honest, it's not going to be complete without him. He's like, he's the family's voice of reason. Even with the argument he and Phil had, everybody depends on him in their own way.
Yeah.
And if you think about it, they kind of did that in the sitcom. It was just scripted differently. You know, Jeffrey was the one in the morning. He made sure everybody in the family had what they wanted for breakfast. When it came to, you could talk, they could talk to him, but again, it was different. So he's still that voice of reason. But I like the way you said, Arlillian. He's like the family's guardian angel. He's always there. So yeah, they, if he doesn't, now he may not come back in the first two episodes, I'll say that, of season two. But yeah, I just believe Vivian is going to be the one that brings him back. She really is. Because if you remember, that was, my mom reminded me of this, that was an episode in the sitcom where he quit because when it was time for his annual review, the pay raise was less than what he thought it should be. And he quit. In that episode of the sitcom, Vivian was the one that stayed on field. She was like, no, you need to bring him back. You need to bring him back because I'm not going to do all this cooking. I'm not going to do all this cleaning. I'm a professor. So yeah, I think she's definitely going to be the one that gets him back in the drama.
Mm-hmm. Good. Yeah.
I look forward to seeing how they're going to do that.
Me too. So as we prepare to wrap up with this season and go to our entertainment portion, what is one thing, I know we discussed a lot, but what is one piece, a teachable moment that you got from seasons? It can be any season, it can be any episode.
It's not good harboring secrets. I definitely got that, you know, because that's something that goes on in my family. Yeah, it's always a secret or something, you know, from my mother and then my mother's mother. You know, the new generation is not like, you know, really doing that. You know, we just telling it how it is. But, you know, back in the days, that's what, like you said, what stays in the house, stays in the house. We know it. Nobody else know it. Just deal with it. And so, yeah. And see, from them harboring that secret so long and so many lies packed up on it, it exploded. So it's good to, you know, try to get your secrets out early or, you know, deal with it early.
Absolutely. What about you?
I think the thing that stands out in my mind, I'm going to go back to Ashley. I absolutely love that conversation that she and Hillary had. Mm-hmm. It was perfect. It was almost like a great introduction to anyone who needs to be on either side of those seats in the chairs, either the one who's coming out or the one being receptive of the person coming out. It's 2022. Get over whatever your ideas are of relationships and love. Mm-hmm. And if you're just accepting to that gem of how it's a sensitive situation, how you should be understanding, how you should be listening and giving advice the best you can, That was I just really love that scene. I love that was brought in there because I haven't seen it yet because I think there are families now upset with Pixar, Disney, because they have a new movie called Seeing Red and it's about abortion and menstrual cycles and things of that nature. Back in the day, those things were taboo. So when we start bringing those conversations in at a younger age so that we can be more comfortable with them, because it's everywhere. And sometimes people don't know how to explain things. So I absolutely love how they approach that situation. That's like one of my favorite parts of that whole TV show.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. My biggest takeaway from all of it is, you know, family is family and you only get one. You may fuss. You may fight, you may follow up, you may stop speaking, but at the end of the day, that's your family. And it's just important to fix those relationships. And Arlillian, as you just said, have those, you know, conversations sometimes that are not the easiest, because at the end of the day, that's family. Mm-hmm. And nobody is family.
Right.
Exactly. So yeah, I hope you've enjoyed our review tonight. This is actually something that we'll kind of do, I don't know, we may do it once a month or we may do it quarterly, but kind of like pick out something in entertainment that kind of sticks out, and we'll spend the whole time doing it. So now we're going to go to the entertainment segment. We have a lot of news to cover. Wasn't trying to put that slide up just yet, but that's something that we will discuss in a few moments. The first way we want to open up, we definitely want to continue praying for the Braxton family in the passing of Tracy Braxton. She was memorialized on last week. Please keep her husband, Kevin Sr., her son, Kevin Jr., her mom, Miss E., and all of the Braxton sisters in your prayers. And also gospel legend LaShawn Pace. She was funeralized on Saturday in a beautiful homegoing service. And this is a clip that I just have to share. Her daughter actually got up during the service unannounced, unrehearsed, and she actually sang one of her mom's songs with the memorial choir. So I just wanted to share a brief moment of that. And that Arlillian Pace, and if you know anything about the Pace family, she has a lot of Pace in her. So please keep her in your prayers. That was LaShawn's only surviving daughter. She lost her first child. I think Zena was 11 when she passed away. So please keep that entire family in your prayers. This is the third loss. They lost their eldest sister last year and then their mom in 2020. So definitely keep them in your prayers. The Grammy Awards were held last night, and we know that we saw some of our favorite artists such as PJ Morton, Jasmine Sullivan, Bruno Mars, and Silk Sonic walk away with awards. But I want to give kudos to a local artist and songwriter, Mr. Sebastian Cole. Sebastian actually won 2 awards for his work on the soundtrack for the United States versus Billie Holiday. He actually walked away with 2 Grammy Awards, so kudos to him. And it's always good when you can congratulate local talent on those, because sometimes you never think you're going to see local talent make it that far. So kudos to him and kudos on his continued work. And congratulations to everyone who won Grammy Awards. Also, we had the Oscars last week. Didn't get a chance to run down some of the wins, but congratulations to everyone who walked away with the Oscars. It was actually a night where we've seen a lot of African Americans pick up Oscars in one night than we have in past. So very great to show you that the hard work is still paying off. We just have to stay persistent. And thank you for that, T. Belinda. Kevin Wooten out of Huntsville, he also walked away with the Grammy. So kudos to Kevin as well. And also, as we continue with our entertainment, I'll go ahead and put the slide up. Y'all, it is finally happening. The Best Man Cast is actually reuniting to begin filming. They've already started filming. It's going to be a limited series, final chapter. So I'm excited. If you follow Morris Chestnut on Instagram or Terrence Howard, they've actually started taking pictures on the set. So this will actually go to Peacock. I can't wait to see how they're going to take it after Best Man Holiday. So we definitely have to stay tuned for this. And I don't know about y'all, but everybody after Bel Air, if you're attempting to do a reboot or a reimagining, you have to step your game up. I'm just saying. Mm-hmm. So
yes.
What makes me feel good, they're using the same writers from the movie. So definitely looking forward to this one as mm-hmm. well.
That's what I was going to ask you. Is that the director? Because I don't remember that guy.
Next yeah, it's...
That was the director.
Yeah. Okay. But it's the same writer, same director. So that makes me feel good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're going to start that show off with some healing, because I remember being in the movie theater and I went with two guys and they were sitting on either side of me. And at the moment at the end, and I guess, I mean, it's so long ago that we can go and say it, when Monica died, they cried harder than me. We were inconsolable. Yeah. That hurt. Like, to see her die. And then when they showed that the baby's name was Monica also, we boo-hooed harder. Like, that hurt. Those were our family members.
Okay,
so I had to open that in a therapy session. Like, that really hurt.
Was that was Moore's Chestnut wife?
Right.
My God. Okay. Her
name's Monica.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was Monica. She had cancer.
Yeah.
Me and my whole family, we went. It was the Friday after Thanksgiving. I'll never forget it. And I looked down at everybody. We just passed some tissue. And like you said, there were guys. I held it together, but some of the men in my family that was there, can't say the same thing for them. I ain't going to call them that. But it was a lot of tissue being passed. And that was, you're right. It does need to start picking up from there. So definitely.
That was one of the hardest deaths I think I've seen in the movie. I mean, we felt.
I agree.
We felt for Simba's daddy, and then we definitely felt for Monica, because that hurt.
Right.
That,
right.
She was a part of our family. We saw her declining in the movie. They had the kids, you know, the dedication of the husband running off the field to go straight to his wife, and then she passed. Yeah, we need
healing. That hurt us deeper than Mama Jo from Soul Food.
Was just about to say that. It's amazing how we get connected to characters.
Right, because, right.
Just like Soul Food, but they did have like a series afterwards.
Yeah, she appeared in this. Yeah.
Yeah, they had a series afterwards, but it didn't last long. But that was another show I was connected to too as well.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Soul Food. That was good. And it is so true how Big Mama, she keeps everything, the Sunday dinners, everything going. And when Big Mama passed, it's like, you know, everybody kind of go their separate ways, you know. Yeah.
And that's something that's real in our families. We don't
talk about
it, but it does happen.
Mm-hmm.
And one final tidbit of entertainment news. Y'all, we can get ready to go back to Broadway. Daniel Brooks will lead Broadway revival of August Wilson's The Piano Lesson. And for those who aren't familiar with August Wilson, he was the writer of Fences, which starred Denzel Washington and Viola Davis. They actually starred in the Broadway version and the film version. And then Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, which starred Viola Davis. And I can't call his name, but he was made famous in Chadwick. Chadwick, yes.
Chadwick Boseman.
Yes, Chadwick Boseman. He was in Ma Rainey's Black Bottom too. So August Wilson is probably one of the best playwrights of our time. And I'm not just saying this because I did The Piano Lesson when I was in high school, but it's a fantastic drama. So it actually premieres on September the 19th at the St. James Theater. And Samuel Jackson's wife, LaTanya Richardson Jackson, she's actually directing the production. So it's going to be very good. So for those who are looking to get away from Birmingham to experience Broadway, this is definitely a production that will not disappoint you. And
Orange is the New Black, she is my girl. I love her. In every scene that I've seen her I love her. So I'm glad to see her diversifying and get into things that I can actually go see her in person in her craft.
And of course, Danielle is also going to be the new Sophia in The Color Purple.
Did she play
Mahalia Jackson
on Lifetime?
So definitely looking forward to that cast. They've been announcing here and there. Of course, we know Fantasia's going to be Silly, and they just announced Ciara is going to be Nettie, and Shook Avery will be Taraji P. Henson. So definitely looking forward to how that all comes out. And then last but not least, Regina King was being shown on set. She is filming the biopic of Shirley Chisholm. Of course, this is her getting back to work after the tragic passing of her son. So definitely looking forward to the biopic. Shirley, of course, Shirley Chisholm was the first African-American woman to run for Congress, and she won. She was also the woman, first woman of color to run for president of the United States. So definitely looking forward to that. So ladies, I want to thank each of you for—
Can I mention one more thing?
Sure.
I want to mention the apology that Lee Daniel did to Moesha.
Monique.
Yeah. Well overdue. It's, you know, for them to— I don't care who apologized who— to get together and stop the feuding, and it was well overdue. So yeah.
And I'm glad you brought that up. And here's how I want to end the show. Sometimes forgiveness happens over time. It's easy for me to say how I would react or wouldn't react until I'm faced in a situation. And just keep in mind of that. Sometimes forgiveness happens over time, but thank you for that. I did want to point that out. I'm glad that Daniels and Monique were able to bury the hatchet, because none of us know when we'll breathe our last.
Yes. Wow.
And I think they headed to Netflix already. I think they already have a project.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was really something.
Right. And because he did that, that's going to get her more work from other actors and actresses.
Yes. Yes. See, that's the thing. 13 years. And so it seemed like she wasn't even working or doing anything, you know, because of the incident. Everybody, she hard to work with or whatever. She's because of that. Things, I don't know,
but they haven't been really big. So kudos to her. Yeah. And regardless of what, Monique is a funny actor, funny comedian. I still look at reruns of the Parkers like it came out.
Yeah,
looking forward to see what happens from that. And here's a quote that I want to end. It wasn't by coincidence we talked about that. True forgiveness is when you can say thank you for that experience. I'm gonna read that again. True forgiveness is when you can say thank you for that experience. And that's from Miss Oprah Winfrey. And ladies, I want to thank you for joining me tonight. And ladies and gentlemen, get ready for next Monday, which will be our Easter experience part two. So if you joined in last year, you know we had some good singing. We shared reflections of what the Easter season means to us. So get ready for next week. We will be on from 7 to 8:30. And as always, keep the faith. Have a great evening, and we will see you back next Monday.
Bye-bye.
It's been a pleasure.
Yes.